Upstairs at Froelich's, show 413, reel 1.
Let's get into season 5, the final season, or not the final, but the most recent one. Let's say that, because this show's still going, isn't it?
It is still going. Cobra and season 5 Kai. Is just, I love this season to death.
I finished editing, the first episode, which covers, I guess, mostly we're talking about the movies, right? We were talking about the movies for half of the running time of this particular episode, and then we started talking about season 1. And then we moved on from there. But it was really great. I mean, I got to go back and find screen caps and original trailers for the Karate Kid, the first four Karate Kid movies back at the beginning. So I was able to look at all that and be able to see all the incredible changes in Ralph Macchio. It kind of reminds me, of, like, you remember in Starman where Jeff Bridges, the character starts off as a baby and it grows very quickly into a teenager, and then it very quickly grows into an adult male.
Yeah.
In front of Karen Allen, and she fucking passes out because there's a naked man in her living room that looks like her dead husband. That's, I'm thinking, what happened to Ralph Macchio when he grew up? He just kind of, some parts of him cooked a little too long, you know? Zabka aged gracefully. Zabka has a really, he is worn in all the right spots, basically, and he looks like he's lived, which is very refreshing. Macchio kind of looks like, you know, interestingly enough, even though he is Southern Italian, he looks like he stayed out of the sun. Probably because he knows to stay out of the sun. That's what you do. If you want to avoid wrinkles, stay out of the sun.
Yep.
Or wear a hat.
If all possible.
Wear a large sun hat. It, apparently, throughout this entire season, you know, Schlossberg and Held and Hurwitz did not write any of these episodes, though. They might have been running the show, but they, I guess, the last episode they wrote together was the season premiere of the fourth season. Before that, they wrote every single story, at least, and had other people come in and write the screenplays. But for this season, there is no involvement on that end.
Which I'm fine with. I mean,
I don't know,
dude. I love the writers they got. They're doing justice to the show. I will say this though: season 5 is, for lack of a better word, it's a little cringe in spots and it's a little hammy.
Where do we last leave off in season 4? What happened there?
We left off with the All Valley Tournament that, you know, Tori Nichols, like Cobra Kai, quote unquote, won the tournament.
They didn't, though. I mean, we know this. Terry bought a referee. Tori knows. Tori went to Kreese. Tori said that Terry cheated, basically. And Kreese wants his revenge because Tori, not Tori, sorry. My girl didn't do anything. She's just angry. Silver framed Kreese for beating up Richard Jewell there. And Richard Jewell went along with the story and was bought off.
Why can't you just call him Stingray?
Because he'll always be Richard Jewell to me. The guy, this is so weird because he's such a left field casting choice. It took me a few episodes to recognize him until I saw his name in the credits, Paul Walter Hauser, right? And I saw Richard Jewell. I saw that movie and he was brilliant. He became Richard Jewell, and it's kind of disappointing to me because Kathy Bates got the nomination for his mom for that movie, but
he didn't, and
he completely channels this character, and he is wonderful. And I knew about him for years anyway before Richard Jewell because I saw the trailer and I was like, oh, that's Paul Walter Hauser. He's a stand-up comedian, and he was on Portlandia. He made a couple appearances, and he's from Saginaw, which is where my wife was born. So he's a Saginaw native, like my wife and my father-in-law. All three of them were born in Saginaw, as was Stevie Wonder, by the way. I want to point that out. Little trivia for you kids out there.
Interesting. It but is. Yet you still can't call him fucking Stingray.
No, because he's not Stingray. He's also, it seems like he lost a lot of weight too, because he was kind of a big guy in the Richard Jewell movie. He was like really a lot bigger, and he must have dropped like 150 pounds or something to play this part. And it's also really weird because he does not have the body for karate, you know?
No, but that's what good choreography is for.
But he's like, he's kind of like bumbling comic relief. That's the only thing I really don't like about your boy Stingray.
I never said he was my boy. I just like calling him Stingray.
Well, now he's your boy.
I will, as much as I hate to admit it, he was one of the weaker parts of the season. Like when I wasn't a big fan of all the Stingray stuff. Especially,
I don't like this Big Bang Theory nerd thing with the Dungeons and Dragons and the PlayStation. Yeah, yeah,
that is the one part of that episode I kind of like. Now I fast forward through it because it's kind of like boring as shit, and I'm not too like, dude. The whole reason I love She's Five, dude, just seeing Daniel, Johnny, and Chosen all fucking together, dude.
They
right there.
They're because Netflix gives you these little thumbnails of the show, as you know, when you go and pick it to watch it. And there's a thumbnail, and I was like, I was curious because it's season one. It's kind of a spoiler a little bit because when I was in hip deep into season one, this thumbnail showed up, and it was Johnny. And it was Danny and it was Chosen all together teaching the kids in the thumbnail. I'm like, why are they all together? Oh, are they going to are they bringing Chosen back? I didn't even know they were bringing Chosen back. I didn't know any of that. So they tend to spoil a little bit with their thumbnails.
Shame on you, Netflix. That ain't right.
Luckily, it still left me asking questions, though. But
I think
season five kind of starts off on a weak note because we have Miguel going to Mexico.
Miguel finding his father.
And
you
he finds
and
out that his
agree.
Father apparently is Lalo Salamanca or some shit. Basically. He almost looks just like him. He's got the mustache and everything. And he acts all friendly and everything. But he looks like he'll turn psycho on you in a second.
Yeah.
I mean, like, Carmen kept telling you, he shouldn't know about his father. And he's like, and she's telling Johnny, with whom now she has a relationship. And now... this season, they're expecting a child because Johnny's a bad boy and doesn't use protection.
No, he did use protection. He just used bullshit condoms from the fucking gas station.
What, did he use Korean condoms?
Yeah, he used, like, fucking, I'm not going to use the term Walmart condoms. I'm just going to say these gas station bullshit condoms, you know? Too cheap to buy fucking Trojans, man.
Oh, I got a feeling that, I think Johnny prefers bareback, if you know what I mean.
He likes raw dogging it, you know.
Raw dog. Okay, I took something that was beautiful and poetic, and you made it sound disgusting. Jesus.
What? Okay, excuse me for being 40 and I have having a different vernacular than you do, okay?
Well, I got
you
the same vernacular.
I can't help it raw dogging, okay?
Can I just say, I have that mind too, but not there. I usually, whenever they talk about Kim Sun-young, I always think of Cream of Some Young Guy.
Okay.
And they keep saying Kim Sun-young. I trained with Kim Sun-young, and it's like, you trained with Cream of Some Young Guy.
Okay, all right, fine.
And there's also Tang Soo Do, which kind of sounds dirty too.
No, yes, sir. It's Tang Soo Do, not Tang Soo Do. Tang Soo Do Do. That's where you're
Tang
going.
Tang Soo Do Do. Ruby Roo. Anyway, so he finds
Run
out.
One,
I don't know quite what his father is, but these Mexican. It's a little bit racist because they make these Mexicans look stupid just because Robbie and Johnny are wearing these shirts that say FBI. But it actually means federal body inspector or something. But they assume that they're with the FBI. Like, the FBI goes around wearing shirts that say FBI on it, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Like
that,
dude,
seems a little bit condescending and patronizing.
A little bit. They should have extended that whole... I think that should have taken 3 episodes to do and not 2.
Why not just have... If it is a story arc, instead, it's a 2-parter kind of mini story arc, and then we forget about it for some reason, right?
I have a theory. I don't know if you'd like to hear it, but
go ahead.
I think the whole reason they introduced Miguel's dad, because you noticed that he's like a fighter or a fighting promoter or something like that.
I don't know. He seems to be sponsoring these blood sport events with Jean-Claude Van Damme or some shit, right?
You know about the whole Sakai Sakai thing coming up? Daniel's dojo is going to join, whatever.
Wait, George Sakai?
I think that Miguel's father is part of it already.
So you think there's going to be some kind of a triangle here?
Well, I think in season 6 is going to be centered around the Sakai Sakai, and when they all get there, Miguel is going to see his father. I think Miguel's father is going to be there. I don't think they're going to sweep this one under the rug. I mean, again, that's just my opinion. That's what I think. It's, again, right at this point, it's a theory, you know?
Well, yeah. I mean, why do you introduce the character only to say goodbye?
Yeah, it's like, I don't... It's like, okay, best example... And same network, so it holds relevance. It's not like that bullshit Stranger Things season 2 where they brought in that one fucking other telekinetic character, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah,
but
yeah.
Then,
God, I hated that.
But then,
what was that? 8?
Yeah, but then
8
now,
was her name,
but here's
right?
The thing. Season 3 and season 4, she is nowhere to be fucking found. Like, they literally introduce a character, and they swept her under a fucking rug.
Yeah, they do that occasionally. Like, okay, Nikki and Paolo on Lost, that was two characters that were introduced and then killed in the same episode. And then there was one more. Odette. Odette is Moira's girlfriend in an episode of Handmaid's Tale. She was introduced and then died. And for no reason than to just create, I guess, pathos in the character. But here, at least Miguel's dad is alive and breathing and part of this whole thing. But I don't really understand what he is. Is he some kind of criminal?
Again, if my theory holds water in season 6, we can find out more about him. I think this was just a quick way to introduce him, to let him know it's like, hey, you now know he is a dangerous guy. But as to how dangerous he is, maybe we'll find out next season.
I don't know. Is he dangerous, though? I mean, okay, there are a couple of things here. You have some kind of a cage match going on, but there seem to be a lot of people, and it seems to be very popular. Then you have him being nervous about people with the federal booby inspector showing up. Then he just sort of disappears back into the whatever it is.
Right.
It's like something that, I mean, like, you're trying to imply something without directly saying it.
And I agree with you, man. It's like, dude, a lot of people have problems with this. And I agree.
It's a little weak.
It is a little weak, but I'm hoping. It, like, dude, this little weak spot has potential for a great payoff in the next season.
Right.
So that's why I can't, like, totally hate it or say that it's terrible, because I think it's building towards something. I really think it is. But, hey, if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. I mean, other than that, though, the rest of the season's fucking great.
Well, after that, after, I guess, Miguel realizes, well, you know what, he may be my biological dad, but he's bad news. I'm going to latch myself to Johnny and call him my surrogate father, and he's going to be a surrogate father anyway if these guys get married. Did they get married?
No, not yet.
They haven't gotten married yet, so they're living in sin, basically. But around this time, Terry Silver and his... I forgot, did you tell me last time what it was that how he accumulated his fortune? I forget.
You don't know. He's just rich. But you know a line in...
But it's not daddy's money or anything, right?
It's not daddy's money or anything like that. He's self-made. It's just, you do know that in Karate Kid 3, he is being fined for illegal dumping or something like that.
Yeah, he's like evil with the ponytail and the hot tub.
He's your quote-unquote generic... He's a generic industrialist. That's all you need to know.
80s industrialist.
Well, but apparently he's still thriving because he's got all this money to open up all these fucking dojos.
He's like that guy in that... Remember that Charlie Sheen, Emilio Estevez movie, Man at Work? He's like an evil industrialist played by John Getz, who has a ponytail, too. That's why I'm telling you, all the 80s bad guys had ponytails.
This is true.
So he's...
Except for Seagal. He was the one good guy who had a ponytail.
Yeah, but he had a receding hairline, too. That made no sense. It makes no sense to have a receding hairline and a ponytail at the same time. It's like you're pulling your hair off of your scalp. But, and he was going after an evil industrialist in that movie On Deadly Ground. Remember the movie he directed?
Yeah, fucking Michael
Caine. And he made
the
20-minute speech at the end. This is why we have to kill Michael Caine, because he's destroying our precious resources. And Michael Caine dyed his hair.
I know,
I can't
man,
believe
that...
Michael Caine, who is like a great actor, is hired by Steven Seagal. It's like, what the hell am I doing here? Am I some sort of villain? Wait, you're not going to kick me, are you, Steven?
Oh, dude, you know what? He did Jaws the Revenge. He has no room to bash.
Yeah, but okay,
he does
okay.
With Seagal.
I wrote my review of Jaws the Revenge, and I said I think the reason he took that job, not only did he buy a house for his mother, but he also wanted a vacation to the Bahamas. And I think that's why everyone worked on that movie, is because they wanted, like, Joseph Sargent directed the movie.
Yeah.
He just wanted to go to the Bahamas. He didn't care that he was making
a
shark
free vacation.
Because it looked gorgeous. Did you see how gorgeous that place is?
He said in interviews, like he said, he goes, I haven't seen Jaws Revenge, but I've seen the house it bought.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, he couldn't even get his Oscar. He was working on Jaws.
I know, fucking. But at least Cider House Rules. I'm not a big fan of that movie, but at least he got to go up on stage again.
You Princes of Maine. You kings of
you
New
kings
England.
Kings of New England.
What are we doing in season 5? Okay, like Johnny knocked up Carmen. It's very cute and everything. Oh, he goes to a YouTube site. Of course, they have to keep working YouTube into this to teach him how to clean his house and then childproof. It's really funny, though. I mean, it's just really cute.
But you got to give him credit. He actually did do a good job. He actually turned...
You know what? He's actually...
I
like that he tries. I like that
yeah,
he tries.
Because he actually does, like, care about Carmen.
Oh, and of course. I think he loves Carmen. It's
Oh yeah, well, Care About loves. He loves her, and he actually wants to do right by her, and he loves Miguel.
That she loves him, that she allowed him to impregnate her. She's so far above him, you know.
She is, but what can I say? She has a thing for blonde 80s guys, man.
Blonde 80s guys
just
say nerd,
man,
and pussy all the time.
And look at the dream sequence she has. She has that whole fucking Top Gun
dream
sequence.
She has the playing with the boys,
you know?
Except no topless volleyball, but also tongue-sucking action, which is what Tom Cruise apparently did. They did a really good job of kind of like simulating the whole Top Gun thing. And it kind of, like you said, it mirrors his own Here I Go Again fantasy of her. So they both have weird 80s fantasies of each other.
So they're meant to be together.
I have to say the coolest character, though, is Carmen's mom. Because she just doesn't give a fuck.
I love her. Even though she's a little underused this season, she has one really good moment in that one episode, and I'm glad she was in it. Hello, I am Billy the Kid.
I like when she went to the All Valley thing, and she's like, I smoked some weed before we got here.
Yep.
It's like, okay. Apparently Grandma's, dusting
Grandma's
it up a little bit.
Grandma's toking the ganj a little bit. But it is late, but it's 20, and what is it, takes place 2018? It's legal in California around this time, so who gives a shit?
I guess it is, yeah.
It is, it was legal. It's like the whole show takes place in 2018.
I don't know anything about California law, but I do know those people need to get high. They actually, those California people need to get high.
Dude, where do you think I get all my weed from?
Okay. I didn't know.
I'm just saying, no bullshit. It's not,
yeah, but
it's
do they
no,
have
no secret here? I'm a fucking pothead.
Do they have that bullshit
day
tax markup? That 40, 30, 50%?
Fuck no! I just got me a disposable last night for $25.
Cool.
Yeah. I already told you how much it costs out here. A gram of oil out here in the state, Illinois, is, you can't even buy a full gram of oil. You can only buy a half gram, and it's $80.
I wish people,
at the fucking shop.
I wish my neighbors would do what you do, because I have to smell their fucking weed constantly, and it gets
My wife does not allow. I don't even do it in the house because I don't want all that shit sticking to my electronics.
We're like all together. We're in row houses, so the shit wafts in through the window. Especially now it's getting cooler, so you open the windows up for some fresh air, and then you wind up getting a fucking contact high.
I vape my weed. I vape my tobacco and I vape my weed. There we go. So, and my weed kicked my ass last night. That's why I slept in.
Oh, okay, gotcha. Oh, see, I like how it all connects. It all wraps up in a nice comedy bow there.
Yep.
We're moving on, and the main story, I guess, of season 5 is that Terry Silver is getting all of these senseis from other places to because he's expanding. He's turning it into a chain. He's turning it into an Applebee's. It's basically like an Applebee's of dojos. And he's getting all these experts that he knew all across the globe, different
you
types
of people.
You get
points for using Applebee's. I would have gone with Denny's, but...
Can't say Denny's, because this is an Applebee's show, as you know.
Yes, it is. And
it's an Olive Garden show, too. But
it is an Olive Garden show, too.
But it's mainly...
That Olive Garden plug was kind of funny, but a little forced.
It was a little forced.
It was a little forced.
I applaud them. I applaud them for when they have their beverages on the table and they don't completely turn the can to face the camera. They have it only half, so you get an idea. Maybe somebody, one of the producers, was like, it's Sony. They want us to do product placement, but let's not make it look like product placement the most of the time if we can. But when they call out specific brands like Ericsson or Coors Banquet or Olive Garden, it gets a little bit awkward. But
a little bit.
He's going to have this chain. So Chosen, who shows up, Chosen is hanging out with them, of course, starting the helping out with Daniel-san. He goes in as a double agent just to learn what the plan is. And then Terry Silver figures him out right away, actually.
Oh, and then they pull an Inglorious Bastards on that show, which I think is fucking awesome.
What, they carve a crucifix into somebody's, carve a swastika
okay,
into somebody's...
Really? You're getting a little too morbid there, guy.
I mean, swastika, I meant to say, not crucifix.
When he said the whole, what is it? He was pretty much convinced that Chosen was who he said he was until he said a toast.
Oh, that's right.
And then, Chosen should have said Kung Pai instead of Kari.
Yes, that's true.
Because if he was from where he said he was, you say Kung Pai when you have a toast, not Kari.
Exactly.
And it's like, Dreiglaser. This is the German three. You do it the other way, it looks weird.
Yeah.
So they did a little Cool and Glorious Bastards bit. The only difference is he didn't die. He beat the shit out of all them fucking bullshit senseis that they had. That's when Silver knew he had to recruit, like, the ones, like, he had to get some real senseis.
Well, it's interesting, too. The only other pop culture references that you see on The Karate Kid, in the Karate Kid universe, Rocky movies are the thing they talk about, right? And there's a great moment where, of course, he says, you know, he talks about how they work out because they have to get this committee of people, I guess, this global committee, put into, because there's something bigger than the All Valley.
The Sakai Sakai.
Yeah. And so they bring these people over to look at Cobra Kai, but then Daniel and Johnny and Chosen bring their own group for them to study too, because apparently they only thought there was only the one that would have entered from the States. And so they decide to have a little dance off, pants off with these, with between the two dojos to fight.
Yeah, we also cannot forget the whole reason that Daniel and Johnny find out about that is because they go visit Kreese in prison. And then they, you know...
Oh, and then they fuck with him, too. Oh, my God.
It's that, like, no mercy, no mercy, motherfucker. I love that.
But I didn't like it because it was not a nice thing to do. I mean, Kreese is a bad guy. He's Emperor Palpatine and all that stuff, right? But he gave them information in exchange for some kind of...
Just a little dirt on Terry. Because, again, they didn't...
In exchange for the name of a good lawyer, and he just... You know, instead they screw him. They get the information. You shouldn't do that because that there's an imbalance there now. You know, there's a tremor in the force when you do shit like that.
Yep, and which all comes to the end, which we'll talk about in a bit. But
then Johnny makes a reference to Rocky IV. He's like, something working out is climbing up a mountain and going, Drago! You know, it's like, so he wins over this guy just for his knowledge of Rocky. You know, but the other pop culture reference I want to bring up is Game of Thrones. They keep working in Game of Thrones references in the dialogue.
See, you're finding all this stuff. I'm glad it's passing me by. But again, I promised you I'll watch it.
You gotta watch it. You know, avoid House of the Dragon like a plague. I just finished the penultimate episode last night, and I'm like, who gives a fuck? It's just people. Okay, the thing about Game of Thrones, you have to understand, good Game of Thrones is fighting and fucking and blood and sex and gore and all kinds of stuff happening and different plot lines all converging together brilliantly. House of the Dragon is just a bunch of people standing in rooms talking. That's all it is. It's like what they did with Phantom Menace. Did I mention this before? I feel like I've talked to my wife about this constantly. Senate meetings. All they're having is Senate meetings and occasionally riding on the back of a dragon.
Wouldn't you more or less compare that to Attack of the Clones then? Because isn't that one the dialogue-heavy film?
But they all are. I mean, like, well, Sith, I don't know, Sith had a more satisfying conclusion than either of those, but...
And had more action in it, too, but...
But Phantom Menace is basically, I mean, you have Senate meetings. Yes, you do get Senate meetings in Clones as well. That was something, I think that was one thing that J.J. Abrams and the others listened to. They understood that they did not want that in their Star Wars movies. And for that, I applaud them, but still.
Well, I think I told you one of my favorite scenes from this episode, or from this season, was where, and I told you this last time, was where Johnny and Daniel have that little powwow, you know, and then you think that Daniel's going to egg Johnny on, and then Johnny ends up, a cooler head prevails.
Daniel is disillusioned. He gets really upset, and he drinks. He does what Johnny does, which is get drunk.
Well, because he loses everything at this point. You know, his wife is. This is where you also find out that Jessica Andrews,
right.
Finally got it right this time.
Yeah.
This is the episode, or this is the season where you find out that Jessica Andrews from Karate Kid 3 is cousins to Amanda LaRusso, Daniel's wife.
Now, what does that tell us exactly? Does that tell us that Jessica Andrews was simply too young for Daniel and introduced him to her older cousin?
Yes.
That's
what
happened.
It tells us that. That's one way of looking at it. I guess that's fine. I just like the fact that Daniel
loses it
all.
I'm not legal, Daniel. This is my cousin.
Daniel loses it all because of his obsession. You know, he has this unhealthy obsession just to get back Terry Silver and all this other stuff. And it finally comes to a head. Amanda ends up, there's a scene where there's supposed to be like this meeting where Amanda can get on a charity board or something like that. Mm-hmm. And it's at Terry Silver's house.
Right.
And Terry fucks with him. And Daniel causes a scene. Amanda doesn't get that position.
Well, remember how Daniel was calm and chill and laid back in the first season until he got angry. And I think that might be part of the whole next Karate Kid thing, too. Because, like I said, Hilary Swank's character was a very angry young woman. And Miyagi kind of told her to chill, taught her how to meditate and all that kind of stuff. Maybe this is something in Daniel as well. Maybe he is angry. Maybe he is an angry guy, you know?
Well, he has, I mean, he has every right to be angry with everything that's going on in his life at this point. But then it all boils to a head when he just makes a fool out of him fucking self. And then it takes Johnny to calm him down. Like, I thought that was great how Johnny, of all people, lets the cooler head prevail and says, look, dude, you know, what's wrong with you?
Yeah, at least we got back.
It's like, leave it alone.
Right. We got back to the evolution of Johnny, at least in this season. Because I feel like he kind of was pushed into the background a little bit in the previous seasons.
I mean, at the same time, and Johnny, at the end of the day, he has what he wants. Like, he got Robbie out of Cobra Kai. Robbie's back at his house. Miguel is safe back at home, and Kreese is in jail. He said, it's like, to me, those are all wins. I don't give a shit anymore. It's like, Terry Silver, that's your fucking problem. He ain't my problem no more.
Well, what he needs to do, if we go back to the original thesis of Cobra Kai, it's all about his evolution. So what he needs to do, he needs to marry that woman, make an honest woman of her. He needs to move out of there. They need to find themselves a nicer place, and maybe all four of them can live together. Maybe, hopefully, maybe his ex there cleans herself up, and she just goes to meditate. I mean, she's just, she kind of like, his ex-girlfriend there is like, she exists to just disappear. She just, every scene that she's in, she's leaving. So she's going someplace else. Maybe she'll come
back. Well, but they give her a little context in the season. Like, she is coming to pick up Robbie so he can stay someplace for the summer, because they already allude that it's summer vacation. But
I didn't really see any of that. I didn't see any. I know she said it, but I didn't see it.
Well, he was going to go stay with relatives, but then Johnny was the one that said, hey, why doesn't he let him just stay with me for the summer, you know?
Mm. You know, what is she in rehab for anyway? Is it alcoholism?
Oh,
she's drinking.
She's a pill pop. She's a fucking
so she
pill
just
popper.
She takes a lot of like pills, so pharmaceuticals.
She's basic for to, a generic way to put it. She's a former opioid addict.
Okay, so like painkillers, like OxyContin or Vicodin.
Yeah, painkillers, like Oxy, Vicodin, that kind of stuff. She's just a pill popper.
So, but she's getting them from her doctors, right?
I'm no.
Or is she just buying them illegally? Can you do that?
It's because she has sugar daddies. That's why every guy she goes out with is a fucking sugar daddy.
And they buy her pills?
And they buy her pills and all that other stuff. I mean, look, dude, it's...
I must have
caught... You look at season...
I must have
look at the
that.
End of season two, man. She's... Or season one or whatever it is. It's like she's so behind or she's so drugged out she can't even pay her fucking bills. There's no food in the house for Robbie to eat. She
I don't,
can't
they
even
didn't
pay
really,
the fucking rent.
Okay, but they... But the problem is they didn't really show that, though. They just sort of...
So her... I get what you're saying. Her, she
they
is
just sort of like carried
character.
It over
her
an exposition, you know?
I mean, but she just like...
I mean,
said,
obviously,
she's
a shitty
away.
Mom. We saw that. We saw one scene there where... He goes into their apartment and they've cut off the electricity, and she just goes off on extended weekends with these guys and then comes back and assumes that he can take care of himself. So obviously we kind of get that with the, we get the shitty mom story angle with that. Right.
Right.
But we don't really go back. We just suddenly, I don't know. She has what? She has a moment of clarity and then decides that she's going to go.
Yeah.
Into rehab.
She, yeah. It was in season two,
but we like don't see it though.
Yeah, we do. There's a whole scene. We don't see the moment of clarity, but we see the scene where she's talking to the LaRussos saying that, hey, I'm going to go to rehab.
I've
got to
go clean myself
up. Together. You're going to stay with the LaRussos while I go into rehab.
See, that's a problem. Now, as a writer, I would say that you're ripping off the audience a little bit. The audience wants to see that moment of clarity because at least you give something to you give us a reason to care about the character. I don't really care about her if she just keeps disappearing and then goes into rehab and then has to go someplace else or something like that after she has exhibited that kind of behavior. Like Johnny, you gave Johnny a chance to redeem himself and you follow him every step of the way. You could at least do that with this character too, because she may not be the star and she may not be that integral, but she is the mother of Robbie. And I would want to see a scene with those two in some way.
I would
give
like
me,
to see,
give
I
me
would ho-
some
I would hope
reward
that
me
I would
for
honest.
Drama.
Let's see what happens in season six. Maybe she'll get a good arc in season six. Who knows?
I mean, Robbie doesn't really get an opportunity to really express himself, and I think that's why he turned to the dark side. And yeah. If he's just angry or something like that, which he was angry, and as soon as these characters suddenly become good again or something, they become a little less interesting in that way. Like, okay, Hawk was interesting, and then he became evil. And then he became Eli again. After, I mean, and he broke his friend's arm, which is fucked up. But I did like that Dimitri caught him and knocked him into the trophy case. That was cool.
That was awesome. I like with the whole, and I was going to get to the Miguel and Robbie thing. I love the fact that Miguel and Robbie are finally cool, that it's all over.
They were a little standoffish, and then they got cool again. And then suddenly now they're going to be related. So, you know.
Yeah, I mean, and on top of that, Johnny, I hate to say it, he did the right thing. He just said, look, you know, Daniel made the great point to him. It's like, you know, back in our day, we just had, you know, the 3 points and this and that. And it was like, you know, we should have just fucking hashed it out. You know, just fucking beat the shit out of each other. No bells, no nothing.
A little, you know, Apollo and Rocky action.
And the funny thing is, they kind of do have that in season four. But then, of course, the fight ends in a stalemate.
Which
there
fight?
Was a,
the water park
fight?
Fight
Johnny and Daniel had the point fight, remember? Because they were clashing.
Oh, that's right.
There.
Yeah. I remember. And they both hit each other at the same time. So it was kind of a tie.
Yeah, it was a stalemate fight.
And they even looked at it on video in the slow motion.
Yeah, and it was total stalemate. But that's, you know, and that's when Daniel finally, you know, got over it and he just said, you know, we should have just fucking hashed it out. We should have just talked this out years ago. We should have just, you know, no points, no nothing.
Right.
And you and I, it would have never gotten as far as it got. And that's when Johnny gets the idea. It's like, hey, no points, no mats. Fucking let it out, man. Just beat the shit out of each other.
Yeah.
And it worked because you finally found out that Miguel actually was capable of showing mercy. Miguel had the upper hand, but he could have ended Robbie, but he didn't do it.
Okay,
and like
so...
you said, I did this to be badass. I wanted to be badass and find balance. You know, I wanted to defend myself and find balance.
So let's get
and
into our Sakai Takai thing, which you still have Tori spying until Kreese tells her basically just to give up. Which is interesting too.
There's underlying reasons for that.
Did it have to do with the rise of Darth Vader or something?
Oh yeah, it basically, yeah, that was his reason why he told her to just quit spying. There's no point anymore. But then, look at how it ended. We'll get into the end. But Tori, like you said, is still the spy for a little while.
That's because Tori figured out. For some reason, the bad guys are very loud. So they're like, this is your bribe money for the thing, and I'm going to talk really loudly so that Tori can hear me in the other room, you know?
Gotta love the 80s, man. Gotta keep the 80s alive. Do the 80s tropes.
It's like, hey, where's the drugs? Where's the money? I don't see any drugs until I see the money.
Another thing I'm glad about this season, you know, the whole Sam and Tori, they don't bury it, but they can finally, for lack of a better word, they can coexist.
Yeah, that is true. I mean, but, well... I think Tori reveals that she's a spy, but the thing is, they have a spy in their midst, too.
Penis breath.
Penis breath. Because they don't Mitch. Call me penis breath. That was
fucking
funny.
And it, like, his real name, by the way, is Mitch, okay?
But he'll always be penis breath to me.
He's always penis breath or ass face, whatever you call, whatever you want to call him.
But at first, okay, wait, we have, this is the famous Hummer thing, because Barnes is, I guess his store was destroyed.
Yeah, we got to talk about Mike Barnes, because that was the whole thing where this is while Daniel was still being a hothead, that we thought that he was under the impression that Mike Barnes could have been one of the recruits that Terry was trying to get. Turns out he was wrong.
Well, they went to Mike Barnes' furniture store, his furniture outlet, Unpainted Arizona, or whatever it's called, and they go in there, and they're like, well, he wants to talk to him, he wants to figure out Silver's thing, you know. I mean, like, Chosen went in there, but, you know, like, he got made very quickly because he didn't know how to salute properly, I guess. And then, or he saluted from a different region. They go in, they talk to Mike Barnes. Mike Barnes doesn't want to be involved in this. Look, I'm selling furniture, okay? You know, leave me alone. Karate's stupid. You're stupid. Get out of here.
And then Mike Barnes ends up giving him the name of the lawyer from the contract he signed over 30 years ago.
Uh-huh.
And then Terry got wind of it and fucking torched Mike's furniture store.
Yeah. Well, that all should be insured, though. He shouldn't have destroyed his entire.
I mean, he said it was all leveraged, though.
Oh, you mean he had it like he was still paying it off? Is that what it was?
Yeah, like he says the line like after, because you were getting back to the Hummer thing, like after you find out that Mike is driving the Hummer, he goes, that place was leveraged to the hilt, Daniel. I lost everything. It's like my wife, all that other stuff. That's when at the end he steals the Rembrandt, which is fucking awesome. But how are you going to sell that motherfucker?
How are you going to sell it? I never understood that about, like, when you steal priceless art. It's traceable. I mean, I don't understand how you would.
Yeah, but this is Mike Barnes. If he was able to get coke to fucking fight Terry Silver, or barely fight him anyway, he probably knows a guy who could fence some stolen artwork or some shit.
Or maybe say that it's not an original. It's just a very good reproduction of it, and then you could maybe make some money from it. Something like that. I don't know. But
you
if
see,
you try
now,
to tell
I'm,
somebody that it's an original work of art, that's theft right there, because there's a chain of title, you know, property and all that.
I like Mike Barnes in this season, but unfortunately Sean Kanan's acting hasn't gotten any better because he really hams it the fuck up.
He kind of reminds me, he's a little bit, he reminds me a little bit of William Zabka.
Yeah, but Zabka
he has
can
a kind
still,
of, like
Zabka
I said, unrehearsed
still
quality.
Act, though. Zabka can still act. That's the thing.
He can, but he's just kind of like being himself, you know? Oh, you're telling me that Mike Barnes is kind of like doing this Chris Farley thing where he's trying to act, you know, like in Tommy Boy.
Yeah, you got it. That's exactly what he's trying to do.
Yeah, when Chris Farley does like this tough guy thing, you know, he's kind of almost got this you're going to be living in a van down by the river kind of vibe to him. It is funny, but he's in way better shape and he's not always pulling up these incredibly tight pants. That was like the funniest thing.
I still love this.
God bless Chris Farley.
God bless Chris Farley. We still miss him.
Tommy Boy is one of my favorite movies.
It's been over 25 years, man.
It's still one of my favorite movies. I love that film. My wife can't stand it. She hates that movie.
Me and my wife both love that movie. When I married her, she wanted to buy it on Blu-ray. She bought it.
Oh, man, that's awesome. Yeah, she's not a Chris Farley fan, except for that Van Down by the River guy. Oh, and the Chippendale scene with Patrick Swayze and Saturday Night Live. But
so she didn't like Black Sheep?
No. God, no.
She didn't like Beverly Hills Ninja?
The only thing she liked, I think, about Tommy Boy was Fat Guy and a Little Coat.
Fat Guy, Little Coat. Richard, are you watching Spanktervision? It's like, oh, what does that remind you of that one comedian, Buddy Wackett?
What's your favorite team? The Yankees?
Yankees. It's like, no, it's like, oh, that's a lovely girl down there. I wonder if she goes out with one of the Yankees.
Hey, everybody, it's Papa Smurf.
It's like, hey, Richard, who is your favorite little rascal? Alfalfa
or Spanky? Spanky?
Sinner.
What a fun movie. I love that movie.
God bless HBO. That was how I saw it back in the day. Fucking
that
HBO.
Line? He's doing his mommy? Jesus Christ. Anyway, so back to Cobra Kai.
Yeah, Mike Barnes. Underused, but
great to see
you
though. I mean, like,
great
he's...
to see him. Great to fucking see him. Dude, I'm just glad Chosen got the spotlight in this season, that it was like all Chosen, because Chosen was like the MVP of this fucking season. Chosen was everything in
this
show.
You know, it's so weird, though. I mean, I was, like, watching when I was watching Karate Kid Part 2, and I was doing some screen caps. I grabbed some screen caps for the episode, and I'm looking at this kid, and it's Chosen. He was such a kid back then, right? And he was also kind of a piece of shit for some reason, because he was, like, a villain. And he was, like, beating a crap out of Daniel. And then he's, like, an old man now. It's so bizarre. He's like really like kind of wrinkled and everything.
Well, he's aged in the face, but like body wise, he's still got it. Okay. According to what they said, he's been keeping in shape throughout all these years. When they called his number, he got back into more shape.
He's 63.
I mean, of course,
he's 63 years old. He's basically
still looks pretty.
He
looks good.
Well, he's basically almost a baby boomer. He's like that in that generation between baby boomer and Generation X, Generation Jones they call him when they're late. When they're late 50s, early 60s, they call them Generation Jones. It's like a sort of a bridge between the boomers and the Xers.
So Daniel and Chosen are both baby, or what is it, baby Georges, whatever you just called them.
Generation Jones.
Generation Jones. There you go. I'm thinking George Jones. That's what happened.
George Jones.
I don't know where that came from, dude. I'm still half-assedly waking up. I told you that.
And this is also the season where we get Robin Lively for a little bit, and she can share...
Just for a little bit.
She can share a little bit of a horror story about Terry Silver.
Literally says, he drove a spike between Daniel and Mr. Miyagi, and they almost didn't recover from it.
I don't remember. What was the deal? I forget the separation that was going on between Miyagi and Daniel in Karate Kid 3.
Daniel wanted to compete in the All Valley, and Mr. Miyagi would not allow it.
He didn't want him to. So he kind of turned his back and then wound up training at Cobra Kai under Terry Silver.
Well, because...
And Terry Silver also... Okay, this is the evil thing. Terry Silver was paying bullies, or making his kids bully him, while at the same time he's teaching him how to fight against these bullies. So he's kind of like... He's kind of like that the mob that breaks your windows and demands protection money.
Good concept. I like that. But turns out, like you said, Terry's paying all the bullies to get Daniel to sign the fucking form so he can fight.
So
he can
bring out the Sith
Lord. But then
he
knows Miyagi's not going to train him.
Yeah.
And then he figures he's going to get, what is it, now.
But then he winds up going in the All Valley anyway, fighting against Mike Barnes.
Yeah. He eventually does get trained by Miyagi. Because, like, after Miyagi finds out what happened, he finds out the whole story. Miyagi says, okay, fine, I will train you now. Okay, because I know you're getting, you know, Terry Silver and John Kreese are fucking with you.
Yeah.
And then when he gets trained, But even then, at the end of Karate Kid 3, it's a little anticlimactic because, like, dude, the whole movie is hokey as shit. I'm sorry. I love Karate Kid 3, but it is the worst of the three. Save for Terry fucking Silver. God, how I love him. Great fucking bad guy. Takes a great bad guy to help a mediocre script. The whole movie makes no fucking sense. This whole vendetta, you know, make his hands bleed, that kind of shit. I mean, I'm sorry. With all due respect to Karate Kid 3, that movie shouldn't have existed.
It shouldn't, but still, it's not a bad movie. I still considered it watchable.
All three of them are watchable. And, I mean, 30
years and the Swank one, Hillary Swank one, that was watchable too. I mean, they were all of a certain kind of drama. You really do find yourself invested, however unbelievable it might become. Yeah, 3 was definitely unbelievable because next Karate Kid wasn't. That was a different kind of. It was a drama.
It was ground. 4 was at least grounded. 3 was just like over the top.
There are some unbelievable things happening at the end of the 5th season, though, of this show. And I have to point it out because I do it constantly. Uploading videos to YouTube is not that quick. It takes for fucking ever. And especially if you're doing it with wireless handheld devices.
Yes, this is absolutely true.
Plus, you have to go through all kinds of checks. Jeez, I can tell you this much.
Sometimes it doesn't take as long. Like, okay, so I remember when I was doing like videos for my YouTube channel, which I really need to start doing again. If you had an Android device, actually shit would upload way quicker to fucking YouTube if you had Android. But if you were using an iPhone like I use, oh, it took forever. Oh, and on top of that, it takes forever on an Apple device. It takes forever.
No. What happened now is they've added two more points of authorization and validation that are required now. So now you got an extra 20, 30 minutes on top of your upload because now they're checking it for content that, you know, they do their checks right in the middle of it.
Oh, content matches, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, and they're doing all these checks. So now it takes me, if I have, let's say, if I have like a half an hour video, it might take 90 minutes to get the whole thing ready to go. So it might take three times the time, you know? Anthony turns into a fucking bully, and I hate that too. How dare this little shit turn into a bully with his friends? And the problem is, if you feel different, you're going to be with a bunch of kids that also may have that in common with you. And then what happens? You turn into a group, and then you turn into a mob, and then you turn into a bunch of bullies, because I guess that's just the way it is. It's interesting. It's philosophical in a way. Cobra Kai, I never thought I'd say that. The whole thing is about the evolution of bullies. Where do they come from? You know, they come from those who are bullied, except for those kids I told you about, the kids that were bigger than me. Kids who are bigger than you and bully you. And also, there's a lot of this horrible show. You know what I hate? One of the things I really hate the most, Froelich, is when you have three kids beating up one kid. Because that's what pussies do.
Yes.
Okay, that's the pussy method, is to have three
kids.
That's
where you just say, you know what, you fight me. You know, it's like, if you want to fight me,
you got a problem with me, then one-on-one. None of this bully shit. That's only cowards do that.
Most bullies are cowards to begin with anyway.
Yeah, yeah.
So far with season 5, everything has shaped into place. Then, like you said, outside of the whole YouTube uploading fiasco, you know, we have...
It all starts when they go to...
We have some fucked up shit happens. Chosen almost gets killed.
Yeah, yeah, there's a big fight at the house. This is all...
Which should have never... Okay.
This all started
that fight was
with,
awesome, but should have never happened. Why did those three drunken idiots think it was a good idea to go break into Terry Silver's house?
Because, you know, and also, how does Terry Silver have all of his senseis? He keeps them all in display cases until they're needed and then opens the door.
I know, it's like I take them out of their package when they're ready to be played with, you know? It's like, come on.
He's got
on.
Them
like,
there. I mean, they're at the house. Well, all this started when they did their little tournament to decide who was going to be entered into this Sekai Taikai, right?
Sekai Taikai.
And they decide, well, you guys are so good, we want you both in. And that, I guess, pisses off, you know, the Cobra Kais and all that.
You see, and that's where cooler heads should have prevailed, because even the penultimate episode of that season, that's when Amanda says, look, or even they both say, look, Silver is not going to risk anything right now. He's not going to fuck around. He's done. Like, it's a stalemate right now. We can relax. He's not going to do anything stupid. And they were right. He wasn't going to do anything stupid.
Yeah, but then they went.
He
to,
wasn't. He
they
was
broke
gonna,
into
he
his just, house.
Yeah, they broke into his house. Thank you.
Got a question.
Coked up, drunk ass Mike Barnes for your great, you know, ideas of it all. Fucking idiots.
Okay, I got a question for you. Okay. You're Amanda. Aren't you at this point fucking sick of all of this karate crap?
Well, she was. I mean, to the point where she ended up leaving Daniel, but then she found out how dangerous Terry Silver was through her cousin, and then she decides to come back. But then when she comes back, she finds out Daniel got his ass beat that first time by Terry.
Yeah. I mean, she already started bitching him out at the end of the first season of the show, and she has been a sport dealing with this crap.
She has been. But then finally, you know, at the end of it all, you know, she finally comes to realize how dangerous he really was, because then when she came back, it was too late. He already got his ass handed to him. And what was funny is, yeah, Daniel kind of deserved it, but also at the same time, he was trying to do the right thing with Stingray. Like, he was trying to say, hey, look, man, I'm sorry for what I did. You know, here's a new PlayStation. Sony product placement, of course. Here's a new Sony PlayStation 4 for you, Stingray.
And there's a new Cobra Kai video game.
which, you know what? I'm going to take a picture of that and I'll send it to you. I wanted you to put it in the episode. You can put it in right here. I actually have that game on the Xbox.
Okay. Do you want me to find, wait, on the Xbox?
I have that.
That's
game
terrible. Do you realize
that's
the equivalent of pouring Pepsi into a Coke glass, what you just
hey,
did there?
I have a PS4, god damn it, all right? But you know what? I have Cobra Kai on the Xbox because, for reasons.
Better
okay?
graphics?
I have it
better
for
graphics?
Reasons.
Is that it? Are you saying that the Xbox is better than the PS4?
The Xbox One X is better than
the
PS4.
But the PS4 has a wireless game controllers.
So does the Xbox, your point? No, it's... Dude, no, it's because of the first-party support. Xbox One X games... All third-party games play better on the Xbox One X, but they don't have the first-party software that Sony does.
All right, what I'll do is I'll find...
So, yeah.
I'll find the Cobra Kai video game and just put it on there. I can show the actual game and throw it in.
Oh, show some gameplay. I'll
show
send
some
you
gameplay,
my picture.
Sure,
but
why not?
Yeah.
Can I ask you...
Is
Terry Silver the bad guy in that? Or is Kreese?
No.
Or is it Johnny versus Danny? Or what?
It's all a bunch. It's just all the kids. It's a fucking beat 'em up. That's all the game. It's like a Double Dragon style beat 'em up.
Oh, so it's okay. Mortal Kombat, Double Dragon kind of thing.
Yeah,
fight.
It's not like a Mortal Kombat fighting game. It's a beat 'em up. It's just like a beat 'em up.
But do you have
Dragon.
Johnny going quit?
it's a good little game. But
I put that at the beginning of episode one. By the way, I put Johnny saying to that
quiet.
Kid. Oh, I'm sorry. What I meant to say was quit.
Well, anyway, well, so like I said, you know, Amanda finally embraced the whole thing after Daniel got his ass beat, and she's finally like, okay, look, I got your back, I'm on
but that the final two episodes of the season, you have three converging storylines where we went to Richard Jewell's apartment, then we came back, then we got into a fight, then for some reason there's a scene also where Amanda and Robin Lively's character get into a fucking little bitch fight in the bar, and then they run out yelling and laughing. But then
I like that because that's where Sam stepped up and protected her mother.
Oh yeah, right. I
forgot. That was cool.
Sam was there too. But you're beating up middle-aged women. I mean, it's young women beating up middle-aged women.
Hey,
it's not exactly
why
fair
not
play.
Good chick fight. We need a good chick fight. And then, of course, like you said, this is also the other converging storyline is where Tori and Sam finally, you know, temporarily squash their shit, have an alliance so they can freaking help take down Terry.
Embargo.
And they should and when it's all over, they should just squish it, because you know what? It's like, Tori, you got Robbie. Sam, you got Miguel. Everyone's happy. You know, no more bullshit. You know, just
everybody gets
Sam
a boyfriend.
And Tori can just be neutral. They can be neutral. But Miguel and, of course, Miguel and Robbie, they need to be friends because they're going to be stepbrothers.
That's true. But then stepbrothers fight, too. Hell.
Oh, come on. It can't be any worse than fucking John C. Reilly and Will Ferrell. Are we best friends now? Yep. You can't imagine Robbie going, this house is a prison on planet bullshit in the galaxy if this sucks ass. I'm glad I made you laugh like a little girl. That's all.
Okay. Woo! All right. Come on, I'm an old man. You're going to give me a fucking heart attack here. I dropped dead, a heart attack podcast, man. At least it'll be recorded. My wife will figure out why there's a dead man in the kitchen. Anyway, okay. So they have their little fight. They get their asses kicked. Chosen, you know, you because you don't see Chosen for a little while in this fight, you assume that he was, like, fatally or mortally wounded, right?
You'd think. I'm glad they didn't kill him off, though. That would have fucking sucked.
But luckily, all of them, they all go, they go after Barnes has hijacked a fucking Hummer, which is, like, that is such a James Bond ending of a thing, you know? It's like, hey, where are you going? You're driving us like crazy. I mean, like, I don't, Barnes is, he's not bright, so... He doesn't, I don't know what his plan is.
No, not in the least.
He just sort of like, you know, hijacks and then they go to.
Well, at first he was going to try to beat up Daniel, I think it was, but then that's when Daniel calmed him down and said, look, I'm not responsible for burning down your store. It was fucking Terry. It was Terry Silver. It was all his fault.
But I
you know, and that's when he said, he goes, I'm sorry for what happened. I will promise I will do anything I can to make you whole again. That's what he said.
Yeah.
And
I keep saying that. He does say that a lot, but it's really funny. It's always funny to me when people who are drunk are trying to be sober and they're trying to tell you, no, yeah, we had some drinks, but you have to listen to me. You know, to me, that's just great fun. That's comedy right there. That's what Macho and Zabka do well.
I'm glad, but then,
have the whole. After they get their asses handed to them, basically, at Silver's house, all the kids wind up converging on Cobra Kai so they can find the video that shows Terry Silver beating up Richard Jewell. They can't find it because, of course, you know, Terry Silver's not a moron.
It's been deleted.
He deleted it, of course. But he did, what's shocking to me is that he didn't delete the other video where he basically admits that he paid off referees and all that stuff to Tori. And that's where they get the information. And that's where Cobra Kai finally turns on Terry because they realize he's a fucking pussy. Or he's a rich pussy who pays people off.
Yeah, they just basically realize he's not worth anything. He's not good. And then they all take off their gis and freaking all their clothes.
They all leave. They throw their swag. You know, he bought all this beautiful swag for them and stuff. He got all these shirts. He's, like, modernizing and giving a new appearance to Cobra Kai and turning it into a brand like McDonald's or Burger King, right? But it's all just thrown back in his face. And that's, you think it's pretty much it for Terry Silver, right? I would assume. What is he going to come back with?
I don't know what exactly they're going to charge his ass with because.
Well, no, it's not about the charging. It's about the fact that
his reputation. The Sekai Tekai
people will definitely kick him out. So it's possible they might kick him out for improprieties because it is it's illegal to pay off referees and do all that kind of stuff. So what would happen, obviously, logically, I see the Cobra Kids all uniting under one umbrella, being taught by Johnny, Danny, and Chosen. That's what I see happening. And then they will get picked and put into the Sekai Tekai, okay? Terry Silver's reputation might be ruined. But then,
I still got to deal with Kyler, Penis Breath, and freaking Kenny.
You think those three are going to be the bad guys? Because I don't know.
Well, I don't know. I don't know how they're going to utilize. You see, here's my issue. I don't know where they're going to take those three in season six because.
Why? Okay. Why those three specifically?
Well, no, okay, because Kyler is a fucking asshole.
Yeah, he's an asshole, of course, but Eli was
Kyler
too.
Kyler is an asshole, and you don't want him, you know, being in fucking Miyagi-Do because he's a fucking douche canoe anyway. Okay.
Well, maybe he'll
I
learn.
I don't think maybe he'll learn, but then now what's going to happen with fucking penis breath? Like, is penis he going to get let
I
back
don't
into...
know. You know, the thing is, he's a turncoat, and you don't trust the turncoat.
Yeah, he's a turncoat. He's a fucking traitor. Okay. Here's your other. Okay, your other problem. I'll get to this one too. Hey, okay, so Kenny has to fucking squash his shit with fucking Robbie and especially Anthony.
That's true, Kenny. But
he wants to get in there.
I understand Kenny though. Kenny is a little kid. He is picked on. And he lashes out just like Eli did. You know, the bully become the bully. Kyler was always a bully from season one, of course. But I don't know, maybe, you know, generally what you do in these situations is you just write the character out if they become too inconvenient to your storyline.
The other elephant in the room would be Tori.
Tori is interesting.
Is Tori going to join Miyagi-Do?
I think she could.
And Eagle Fang.
I think she's capable and she is talented and all
that. So do you think her and Sam can keep the truce?
See, that would be really good because I'd love to see some tension. Tension is always good for drama. Remember that. If Robbie and Miguel are going to be family, it's going to be a little bit difficult, but it might be tense. But Sam and Tori, maybe they can learn to coexist or something like that. And that's why I say if there's
maybe, maybe they should do what Robbie and Miguel did and just beat the shit out of each other.
Yeah, why not? Go ahead, do it. With no help from anybody else. That's the other thing. Stop this gang violence stuff. I don't like that. I like one-on-one stuff. It's more honest, you know?
They kind of already hashed it out in season three, though, and it never happened. Like, Sam ended up getting the upper hand on Tori, but then everyone else stopped the fight.
Mm-hmm.
But who knows? I mean, again, there are a lot of different... I mean, season five ended, and of course we got to talk about the big twist ending is that you find out in the very last episode of season five, you think that John Kreese gets shanked in fucking jail. He gets fucking shivved. And it turns out he was not shivved. He faked it. He used all that.
It was a
he
big
was hoarding up
production.
All the jello.
Yeah.
He was hoarding up all that jello, hiding it up his ass or something. I don't know where he was hiding that motherfucker.
Yeah.
But yeah, he faked his death and
so
he was able to.
I mean, like he's walking out, then the last place he should be is anywhere near these people. If they find out that Kreese escaped from prison, you know.
Oh, they already know he escaped. Like that was what they I think they were going to tell them, like when they like, oh, you didn't hear they said that. I think they were about to tell him Kreese escaped. I think they already knew he escaped at that point.
Well, I, you know, the thing is, if I were Kreese, I wouldn't be anywhere near any of those people. Then he should just go.
Because there's like, that's how this season ends. It's going to end on a fucking manhunt for Kreese. So like season six, that's where season six is going to get the dude. They have raised the bar so high for what they're going to do in season six. Now you've got Kreese on the run. You've got the Sakai Takai tournament coming up, and then you've got all these other characters. Where are they going to end up in season six? Are they going to be written off the show? Is this?
I
and
think
this is
maybe,
good
okay.
television, people. This is good television.
What,
I love this
What
shit.
You could do if you want, as far as like figuring out what might happen in season six, I say Kreese goes to a country that has no extradition, possibly out there in the Asian area, and he starts up his own dojo again and gets into the Sakai Takai, and nobody is aware that he is running this dojo, that he's the man behind the curtain.
That could be a thing. I mean, it could be a thing.
They kind of wrote themselves in the corner by having him escape, because if he's escaped, he might get arrested or he's on the run or something like that. So the only thing I can think
of is
that he's in hiding and he's going to emerge with a new dojo, you know.
So only time will tell. We'll see what happens.
We'll see what happens. I guess this time next year. They'll probably have a new season, right?
Yeah, because they, like you said, they bang these things out super fucking quick.
Yeah.
Like, as soon as season four was airing, they already were shooting season five. I think they almost shot four and five back to back. They came very close. But you also know one of the main reasons they did this, for those who don't know, Sholomar Duenya, who plays Miguel, he was cast as the Blue Beetle in the DC movie, so that's why they had to shoot seasons four and five really quick to accommodate his schedule.
Oh, well, at least they kept him and worked with him with his schedule rather than right around him or something like that.
They shot it quick so he could go do his thing, and now I think Blue Beetle's wrapped, so he's going to go back to Cobra Kai season six right away.
Okay,
they did
so,
it so
can
perfect
you just...
to where they...
Can you give me a couple of seconds? What the hell is Blue Beetle anyway? What is that?
Oh, it's a DC property.
Is it a superhero shit?
Yeah, it's a Hispanic superhero.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
And of course, he blew up because of Cobra Kai, so he was the perfect cast. So, like, his career already got a boost thanks to this show.
That's cool.
Now, as far as everyone else goes, who knows? I mean, they could move on to other things. I mean, Peyton List, she's the other breakout star because she's doing some shit now too.
And she's
who
hot.
Plays Tori. And she's hot.
And she's hot. Uncomfortable.
And she's
middle-aged
hot.
Man.
You dirty old man.
Dirty old man. Yeah. Okay. Oh. So that wraps up so far up to this point. Maybe we'll come back next year and we'll talk about season six if we ever.
Yeah, that's the best part. We get it all shit out now. We could fucking do it again in a year.
Yeah.
And then talk about season six, see if we loved it or hated it. And I really hope we can both say we loved it.
So the next time we return, we will be discussing El Camino.
Yes.
Which I'll be getting into. We just started. We finished Breaking Bad on Saturday, and we're now two episodes into Better Call Saul with my wife and daughter. It's interesting watching all that shit come back together. I hope what I want to do is do it exactly the way it's supposed to be chronologically. So once we get to, I guess, season four of Better Call Saul, we'll watch El Camino, and then finally, you know, Regan can have some closure on her beloved Jesse. Because that was her favorite character, and she was very happy that with how Breaking Bad ended.
Good.
Because she hated Walter, too. She just hated Walter. up to that point, she just really hated him. Anyway, yeah, we'll be back with El Camino. So, you know, I'll be the one to say it. Like, share, and subscribe.
Yep.
Okay. So, good night, everybody.
Good night.